Okay, so welcome back. I will be going through with you the this part on chapter nutrition in plants, focusing on the internal and external structure of the leaf and its function in relation to photosynthesis. So for this particular chapter, what you will need to know is how to identify the external part of the leaf, like what are the veins, what is the leaf structure, what is the leaf plate, and also the internal structure of the leaf, which is all the cellular and tissue structure. And not only that, but focusing more towards the internal structure and to relate it to how it's actually able to adapt to its function. It is also to also take into consideration on the outline and the intake of how carbon dioxide and water can actually take place inside the plants. Okay, so let's first look at the external structure of the leaf. So you can see that the lamina or the leaf blade has actually a very large surface area to volume ratio, and this helps to maximize the absorption of light energy or light, sunlight. Okay, so having this very large surface, you expose the whole leaf surface to the light, and therefore you always take more light energy for photosynthesis as compared to it being very wrinkled, very actually close up, very small. And on top of it, underneath the side of the leaf, there's also a lot of stomata pores, and this allows rapid diffusion of carbon dioxide to reach the inner sides of the cell of the leaf. Okay, so this is one of the main benefits of it being actually very large. Second thing is the pedicule. It positions the lamina for maximum absorption. So we are talking about this main section over here. This main thing. Okay, and of course you have the stem. Next we have the veins, which helps to allow the transport of water and mineral salts to the cell. So basically, right, these are all the small little veins that are present in a leaf. And you have this whole thing that is actually known as the midrib. So all this inside has internal vessels. They have to transport your substance in and out of the leaf. Okay, and what are some of these things? They are like your water and also your manufactured food substances. Now, leaves are usually arranged in a regular pattern around the stem, and this helps to ensure that the leaves are not blocking one another from light energy, and of course that each of these leaves will only receive maximum or optimal amount of sunlight. So in a sense, right, if you look from the top, you would see that the leaf, right, is not one after another. Why? Because the top leaf, right, would actually, when light energy is shined downwards, it blocks the leaves at the bottom. So your leaves, they do not actually arrange in such regular patterns. Instead, it is more of like a 4D kind of thing, whereby you have one leaf here, one leaf here, like a cross shape sometimes, such that it gets further exposed of light energy. Okay, so this helps to it's like an alternating arrangement, such that the leaves do not block each other, and therefore each leaf will be able to receive the same the optimal amount of light energy. So it's an alternated arrangement. Okay, so now we look at the internal structure of the leaf, which is actually very, very important. In exam, it is a common MCQ question, it's a common structure question where you are required to label the individual internal structure of a leaf. So the first layer at the top, it's covered by the square box. Basically, it's a cuticle. And what is it? If you refer to your textbook, you will get a better idea of where the arrangement is. So the cuticle is this waxy layer along above your epidermis, which prevents excessive water loss. Why excessive water loss? In the next chapter in transport in plants, we will talk about transpiration. And having this, having a very high rate of transpiration will result in the leaf to actually collapse. It will undergo withering, and therefore you do not have the maximum surface. And what does this actually prevent you from getting? Optimum number, maximum amount of light energy, and the second one is also the your gut, your stomata pores, right, they are not actually open. So this will also affect the rapid diffusion of gases. So waxy layer above the epidermis, which then prevents excessive water loss, this is transparent enough to allow sunlight to actually penetrate into the mesophyll cells. Okay, take note, it's actually transparent. So in other words, right, this waxy layer also can act like a magnifying glass to help to focus the amount of light energy, right, to the chloroplast of the first layer. Okay, and then of course you next the first layer of the upper epidermis is this single layer of closely packed cells. So this is another one that you can take notice of. Okay, then subsequently is this one. Sorry. Do take note, is epidermis, not epidermal. So do take note of the difference. I know a lot of you, the spelling will tend to be jumbled up. So the third one is the important one. The palisade mesophyll cell. So what is this palisade? So what is this palisade mesophyll cell? Is that this palisade mesophyll cell is this layer here. So you can see these cells, right? They are actually arranged at the like one layer by one layer horizontally. That is your upper epidermis. On top of your upper epidermis, there is another layer of a very thin layer, which is a cuticle. And the epidermal cells, the epidermal mesophyll cells, are the ones that are arranged vertically in a regular arrangement. Okay? So this is how you identify. And do take note that the palisade mesophyll cells layer contains the highest concentration of chloroplast in the leaf. And this means that you will also have the maximum amount of light energy being absorbed. Okay, that means your photosynthesis will be very high. Okay, now next layer we look at is the so if you can see over here, this yellow color region here is the cuticle. Whereas this is the epidermis layer, and this is the palisade mesophyll layer. Okay, so do take note. Next is the spongy mesophyll layer. The spongy mesophyll layer is basically this whole item over at the bottom, this whole thing here. Okay, this big in external square. This is the spongy mesophyll layer. Now do take note that the spongy mesophyll layer, they are different from your palisade mesophyll layer. In what sense? They tend to be irregularly shaped and irregularly arranged. But then in between there is a lot of all these empty spaces. We call it the intercellular air spaces. And this is where it aids the diffusion of gas in and out of the plant. Okay? On top of that, there is also the vascular bundles. The vascular bundles is this region over here, where it contains the xylem and the phloem to transport water for xylem and food substances for the phloem. Then you have the lower epidermis, which is in the bottom layer area here. So these ones are the ones that has the stomata pore. Stomata is actually made up of two gut cells, which we will talk about later on. So do remember in exam, if they ask you to label the stomata, it will be like this. What is this? If they ask, they just point to one only, this is just a gut cell. Okay, next thing is if you see this particular layer, there is this like one blue color line there, that is actually the thin film of moisture. That helps to aid thin film of moisture. That helps to aid in the diffusion of your gas in and out of the plant cells, okay, within the leaf. So next thing is to take note is how do these gut cells helps to control the size of the stomata. So for your gut cells, right, generally they are uneven in shape in terms of the size. So what you can see is that in a gut cell, this region here is actually thicker. Whereas the outside is actually thinner. So what happened is during photosynthesis, okay, so this one you need the concept from your chapter 3 movement of substances, where as number one is due to photosynthesis, okay, you will produce higher glucose concentration, right? When you produce higher glucose concentration, this would then reduce the water potential of the cell. So water would then exit the cell. Water will then enter the cell. Water enters the cell by osmosis. Okay, so once water enters into the cell by osmosis, these gut cells will tend to become swelled up and turgid. And when it becomes swelled up and turgid, the gut cells from a very like normal size like this tends to become like a bean shape. Okay? After water enter. And what will happen is, if you can see the area of opening, it becomes bigger. So when the area of opening becomes bigger, the stoma actually opens, and therefore gas can actually move in and out of the cell. This happens during the day. During the night, on the other hand, is the ions, the potassium ions actually diffuse out of the gut cell. And when the potassium ions diffuse out of the gut cell, this water potential in the gut cells would increase. So as water potential in the gut cells increase, water will start to come out of the gut cell. Okay, it exits by osmosis, making the gut cell to become very flaccid, and therefore it closes. And when it closes, there is very little gas to escape, or lesser gas exchange between the inside of the plant and outside of the leaf. Okay, so through this opening, So through this opening, what happens is, okay, the path of carbon dioxide is actually able to go into the plant when the stomata is open, and then the CO2 inside the leaf is then lower than the atmosphere air. Because why? During photosynthesis, all your cells will actually use up carbon dioxide gas. So indirectly, this reduces CO2 as compared to the higher CO2 concentration outside of the leaf. This will result in carbon dioxide to diffuse in by diffusion, and therefore this will actually ensure the continuous entry of carbon dioxide during the day where photosynthesis occur. So of course this film of moisture or water surrounding the cells helps the gas to diffuse into the cell properly. Next is this, water is brought to the leaf via the xylem vessels in the veins. And that waters would then leave the veins and move from cell to cell in the mesophyll cells or by osmosis. So within the cell, it is by osmosis. Within the cells is osmosis. However, out of it, right, is already in the intercellular air spaces, we are talking about water vapor already. Therefore, it will be more towards of diffusion. Okay. So for this particular one, in how is the leaf adapted for the for photosynthesis, I already went through the functions all at the top of the previous slide. You can go and read through it. You can also find out in your textbook for the answers. And generally, that is all that we have studied so far in this chapter. So just to summarize, we saw that photosynthesis, right, covers two, there's two main stages, the light dependent and light independent stage, where the independent stage doesn't require light, so no need light, no need light. And the light dependent stage depends on light, so light is required. So there are a few factors that influences photosynthesis: carbon dioxide, sunlight, which is your light energy, temperature because of your enzymes, then water and chlorophyll. And the importance of photosynthesis is mainly these 3 points. Okay, for food, the only organism that can, one of the few main organisms to convert light energy into a chemical energy which we can take, and of course to maintain the balance of oxygen and also carbon dioxide in the atmosphere through the carbon cycle, which we will cover in another chapter. Then of course, as glucose is produced, you can also can have a lot of different factors. For example, able to form your starch, and this is the one that we test for photosynthesis using the starch, the iodine test. Okay, so that is all for this chapter. I hope that you understand and learn so far. Do read up your textbook for more information. Okay, the Martian Cavendish textbook has a lot of detailed examples and information which will actually help to build up the foundational videos that I have actually shared. The videos are here more to give you an idea of what the chapter is talking about, and at the same time, it should not be the only source for you to study. Okay, please do your own due diligence, and all the best for any upcoming examination. Don't forget to like my video, subscribe to my channel, and also click the notification button for future updates of future videos. Okay, that